Dear attendees, senior colleagues and panelists, it is with great pleasure and ultimate honor I welcome you to the 7th session in 2021 and the 63rd session of the MEGA Medical Association. On behalf of the Educational Board of the MEGA Medical Association and the Egyptian Society of Anesthesiology, I would like to thank each and every one of you for the efforts you are doing to keep the flow of learning and the curve of education rising. Thank you for your time every week, your patience during the mishaps, and the uninterrupted support all the time. Today, we are welcoming back Dr. Samir Elansary to our speaker side, together with Professor Dr. Adel Abdel Fattah Saleh, Professor Dr. Khalid Yassin, and Dr. Iman Nada. On the moderator side, allow me to welcome Professor Dr. Mohamed Ibrahim, Professor of Anesthesia and Intensive Care, Alexandria University, Cairo, Egypt. Dr. Mohamed is also the reviewer of the Egyptian Journal of Anesthesia, and he was the president of Alexandria Society of Anesthesia and Intensive Care 2019. Also on the moderator side, I'm glad to welcome Dr. Essam Manaa, Professor of Anesthesiology at Asyut University, Egypt, Head of Neuroanesthesia at King Khalid University Hospital, KSA, and he is also the editor of Austin Journal of Anesthesia and Analgesia, and he is the reviewer of Saudi Journal of Anesthesia and the Anesthesia Essays and Researches. Dr. Essam, please start the moderation.
Thank you so much, Dr. Hoda Fawzy, for this introduction. Thank you for all the attendees and the speakers. Thank you especially for Professor Saad Mahdi and for all who are watching this MEGA online course. And I am so happy today to introduce this special day with these all of these big names today. I consider today, this day is not just a meeting. It is considered as a conference, of course, because we have a lot of speciality and respected people and big names, very big names who are well known all over the Middle East and of course all over the world. One of these big names of course is Professor Samir Elansary, and he is well known in the his activity and his speciality in the intensive care. And since time we didn't hear from him, but today I am, it is my great honor to introduce the Professor Samir Elansary, the big name in the ICU, to introduce one of his peers in his series of the intensive care. So please, Professor Samir Elansary, go ahead, and all of us, we are listening to you, sir. Thank you so much.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. First, thank you, Dr. My dear Dr. Essam, for this nice introduction. Good evening, my dear colleague. Good evening, our attendees. Today, really, I select a topic which is the topic of our time now, COVID-19. And I select to speak about one item of this disease, which till now, even with this extensive research all over the world and all over the globe, it is still its histopathology and pathology still not known perfectly, really. And most of our treatment is empirical treatment. COVID-19 associated coagulopathy is very important, because if we understand it, and it is not found to the same extent in all over the patients, but I think it varies from one patient to other, and it depends on the underlying extent and intensity of the cytokine storm and the inflammatory state. And so I will try to highlight this item which related to COVID-19. And getting control of COVID-19 really not depend only on vaccination. It will also require better understanding of why the disease causes some problems and some exaggerated symptoms in one patient, so not in others, and why this disease affects other organs in some patients, so not others. And so we have time to search for the underlying pathology and causes and regarding this COVID-19. COVID-19 is frequently accompanied by a hypercoagulable inflammatory state, which with microangiopathic pulmonary changes that can precede the diffuse alveolar damage. And this point is very important, and I think we notice it also in other viral diseases, especially in coronaviruses like SARS and H1N1 and MERS, but I think not to the same extent like in COVID-19. Characteristic of typical acute respiratory distress syndrome are this seen on other severe pathogenic infections, of course. Several post-mortem and retrospective pathology study during H1N1 pandemic revealed to some extent the same pathology which we find in COVID-19, alveolar septal edema, hyperplasia of type 2 pneumocytes, febrile thrombus in the vascular lumen, necrosis of the bronchial wall, diffuse alveolar damage, intra-alveolar hemorrhage, necrotizing bronchiolitis, microthrombi, thrombosis of large pulmonary arteries, and hemophagocytosis, and so on. COVID-19 relies on two host cell receptors for successful attachment to the cells, the angiotensin-converting enzyme receptor, angiotensin 2, and also the transmembrane protease serine 2 receptors, which mostly concentrated in the lung tissue. And so this virus affect mostly the pulmonary system more than the other organ system. It is found also in the other organ system and other cells, but not to the same extent as it is found in the pulmonary system. It is concentrated in the pulmonary system. The extent of coagulopathy in various coronavirus-associated infections widely vary in terms of pathogenesis and the severity of outcome. This mechanism includes multiple processes involving coagulation, fibrinolytic network, and platelets, endothelial cells, and leukocytes. And just the endothelial cells are distracted by the virus, it initiates the pathology of the disease. Fibrinolytic dysregulation and imbalance of serine proteases are also contributory to fibrinolytic deficit in these patients, and even the natural antithrombotic are deficit as protein CS and tissue factor inhibitors and so on. Additionally, periodic monitoring of D-dimers, prothrombin time, platelet time, fibrinogen level are recommended just to guide us for the extent of the inflammatory state and the extent of the prothrombotic state. We have to depend to some extent on these lab results, but mostly we depend on clinical evaluation, and we have to consider there is variable, individual variability in the extent of the prothrombotic state which affect the patient. Reported high D-dimer levels appears to correlate with mortality in patients with severe COVID-19. However, currently it is not defined if this correlation is specific or significant for COVID-19 patients, because we find it also on other critically ill patients due to other causes. Moreover, elevated D-dimer can't be envisioned as a guide for initiation and dose escalation of anticoagulant. We have to depend on our clinical evaluation also to see the extent of the coagulability. There are four stages, of course, of COVID-19 for sporadic cases at first, and then local transmissions from persons coming from outside the infected persons. After that, the community transmission, which is impossible to break the chain of transmission in this stage. As the people are infected, have no clue about how they became infected, followed by this by epidemic stage or stage 4. Also, we have stages of COVID-19 clinically regarding the symptoms, and we must understand the stages of the disease, and because our treatment depends on the stage of the disease. We can't apply different methods of treatment to different stages. We have to select. In the early stage, from day one, the patient may exhibiting some symptoms like dry cough, fever, and so on. And the symptoms may extend up to several days. By day, fever must subside by day 12-13. Cough may persist for the length of the disease, which may extend it up to 21 days. Eyes, difficult breathing and dyspnea and ICU admissions may begin after 12 or 13 days. And we have to understand the underlying pathology in the different stages. As at start first, at start of infection, the patient suffering from viral load. And so we have to use here the antiviral treatment, concentrate on antiviral treatment, followed after that by the inflammatory and complement generation and cytokine storm. And if it is highly extensive, it will lead to prothrombotic and thrombotic complications. And after that, the autoimmune antibody start to be generated. At start of the disease or at start of infection, there is an innate immunity, which it depends on interferon mostly. And after that, followed by generation of autoantibody, which may persist and they may be exaggerated in some patients, and they may extend up to 7 months autoantibody, and they may affect the other organ system, which is the main problem now we faced with COVID-19, which is called post-COVID syndrome, which depends explained by many underlying causes, maybe due to autoimmune antibody generation, maybe due to extensive inflammations, maybe due to microthrombi, and so on. And so we have to understand the underlying pathology and underlying pathophysiology of the disease to guide us for good selection of the empirical treatment which we have now. Day 7, breathing may become difficult or liver. Day 9, the sepsis may start and other superbacteria by bacterial infections. Day 10, 12, COVID-19 start to have an improvement in some patients and others not. After that, acute respiratory distress syndrome, if the immune system is not perfect in its action, especially the adaptive autoimmune system, not the innate immune system. And so day 12, the median day for admission to the intensive care unit if the patient is not improving. Day 15, acute kidney injury, cardiac injury, and other organ system affection. Day 22, this is a median time or medium amount of days for COVID-19 survivor to be released from the hospitals, and the other unlucky patients will persist or stay in the hospital after 22 days. The vaccines which are available now and the clinical trials, any vaccine now must be subjected to 3 trials. And we have now more than 60 vaccines are still going through 3-stage clinical trial process. And as most of us know, it is compressed, all these stages, compressed because we are in urgent need for this vaccine. And given the urgent need, some vaccines developed have compressed the clinical process of SARS-CoV by running the trial phases simultaneously. And as we know, it is subjected to 3 phases, phase 1, phase 2, phase 3. Phase 1, just to check the safety of the vaccine on small group of healthy humans and see if it has any side effect. Phase 2, widens the testing pool to include groups of people. Stage 3, it is expands the pool up to thousands of patients, giving that the immune response can vary by age, ethnicity, and by underlying health condition. And these are some of the vaccines available that have made it to phase three trials and beyond. And I think it will be mostly ready in the few days, in the incoming few days. As Moderna, AstraZeneca, Oxford, Sinopharm, many vaccines, Johnson and Johnson, and these vaccines depend on different mechanisms, really. If we speak shortly about types of vaccines available, it may depend on nucleic acid injection, like messenger RNA and DNA, or knocked out virus, which is attenuated virus or inactivated virus, or weakened virus, which is ordinary vaccine, which we know. Other vaccine depend on injecting the piece of DNA from SARS-CoV-2 into a carrier virus, another carrier, not harmful virus, as adenovirus generated in monkey and injected into the human. The modified adenovirus is injected into humans. The hope is that it will instruct the cell to make coronavirus protein and will trigger an immune response. The other type of vaccines depend on just taking the protein from the virus in part of protein like spike protein and incorporated it in nanoparticles and inject it into the human cells and the cells generate protein like coronavirus, which stimulates subsequently the T cells to form the antibodies. COVID-19 associated coagulopathy clinical manifestations, of course, critically ill COVID-19 patients without other risk factor for thrombosis manifest with various thrombotic event, prothrombotic state, including microvascular thrombosis, venous, pulmonary thromboembolism, acute arterial thrombosis, stroke, myocardial infarction, any type of stroke, peripheral perfusion deficit in the lamp, in the periphery, and so on. And even your patient subjected to catheter or to renal replacement therapy, you will find him suffering from frequent clotting of the tubes. And so the patient at this stage is subjected to prothrombotic state and he need anticoagulant. Ultrasonography, really, we depend on ultrasonography for detecting the prothrombotic state, especially if we find the amorphous echogenicity in the major veins, greater than that of adjacent femoral artery, which is suggestive of slow venous flow. And mostly this has been associated with an increased rate of DVT in subsequent examinations. If the vein is fully compressed, of course, you can exclude thrombosis at the site. The characteristic lab finding for COVID-associated coagulopathy are we find dramatic increase in D-dimer and D5P in degradation products, and this mostly is indicator or parameter for initiating prophylactic anticoagulant. BT, BTT, and platelet count may be dearranged in the advanced cases or at starting of DIC. D-dimer level also correlate with the rising venous thromboembolism with a reported sensitivity and specificity and the positive predictive value of 70% if we take a D-dimer level of 3 microgram per mL or 3,000 nanogram per mL, it is highly specific. An association of antiphospholipid antibody also must be searched tested in such patient in COVID-19 patients because a highly percentage of patients may be more than 50% associated with anti-cardiolipin, immunoglobulin A, and also glycoprotein 1. And maybe mostly lupus anticoagulant negative in such patients. Progression of coagulopathy to overt DIC, as indicated by International Society of Thrombosis and Hemostasis, DIC score of 5 point or higher is seen in 71.4% of all non-survivors. And so it is a marker, a good marker for a prognostic marker for such patients. We can depend on it. Fibrinogen level also, which are elevated in the initial phase, drop late in the course of non-survivors, and they may signal an impending death. COVID-19 patient examined for thrombocytopenia as a marker of severity of disease, and this is very important in some patient in some patients exhibiting severe thrombocytopenia, and we have to give some platelet stimulating factor like bromotage. These are the markers which mostly we depend on as C-reactive protein, ferritin, D-dimers will be increased and signifying more inflammation, signifying more thrombosis. And so at this stage, the patient may need some drugs to decrease the inflammation and decrease the thrombotic state as anticoagulant. You can use at this stage the dexamethasone or tocilizumab or sibrimab or bacitracin recently. All these drugs can decrease the severity of inflammations and decrease the cytokine storm. And also complement generation is highly generated in such patients. And they try now through many studies to using or searching for complement inhibition and it give a good results. Histopathology in COVID-19, we will find the diffuse alveolar damage with profound inflammation, thrombosis, thrombotic microangiopathy of small vessels and capillaries of the lung, and maybe mimics the atypical hemolytic uremic syndrome. Exactly, we see thrombosis and we can see other organ affection and at this stage. Megakaryocytes also within the pulmonary capillaries with nuclear hyperchromasia and atypical. Neutrophil partially degenerated also. Endothelial cell injury and diffuse microvascular thrombosis suggested of thrombotic microangiopathy, and it may affect all the organs of the body, but mostly it affects the vessels of the lung if in most of the patient. It's also reported in extrapulmonary organs, and they may explain acute onset of multi-organ failure without an otherwise obvious etiology. And I think these typical pictures we saw before, most of us saw it before in H1N1, in SARS, COVID-1, in MERS. And so it is not unique to COVID-19 only, and I think it but may be severely affected in COVID-19, but in other viral, especially coronavirus, it may affect the other organs and give us the same picture. Pathophysiology of this disease, COVID-associated coagulopathy, is likely multifactorial. And the patient share many of the classic venous thromboembolic risks. The patient is not ambulating, the patient with catheters and the systemic inflammations. All these are underlying cause with the generation of the cytokine storm, especially interleukin 1-6, and the tumor necrosis factor alpha and other inflammatory cytokines. And so the anti-inflammatory cytokines play a good role in such situation, as I told, as tocilizumab and sibrimab and bacitracin. Inflammation is known to promote thrombosis through various mechanisms, including activation of endothelium, and this is the initial step in injurious effect of COVID-19 to all the capillaries of the and all the cells of the body. Platelets also, monocytes, and the tissue factor and factor active 7 pathway. And so there is some dysregulation between the complement system and the fibrinolytic system and the intrinsic and extrinsic coagulation pathway. And recently, I think the autoantibody play a high important role in the generation or in the extent of this disease. Altering the fibrinolysis and the natural anticoagulant pathway through thrombomodulin or protein C and the S and the tissue factor pathway inhibitor, all of these natural anticoagulants are decreased in its level. Endothelial cell activation, a unique mechanism of COVID-19 mediated microvascular injury, thrombosis, subsequent multisystem organ failure, intense inflammation with thrombosis of pulmonary vessels, which lead at the end to RDS, which looks like other etiology. Complement activation is a major contributor to lung injury and other organ failure. And the complement inhibition here, through many studies in these models, reduce organ damage and inflammation. Especially active C3 and C5 play important role in suppressing this highly cytokine storm. Management of such patients, you have to balance the risk and the benefit of empiric therapy. And as we know, till now, all our treatment which are available is empiric, while minimizing the use of resources. And so we try to avoid subjecting our patients to an extensive investigations, which we can depend on other simple one to avoid the spread of the disease. Management strategy currently vary greatly among institutions and are likely to change as we learn more and more about this novel disease in the near future. Lab testing, which is very important, as you said, D-dimer, BT, BTT, D-dimer more than 3,000 nanogram per mL, fibrinogen equivalent units as the threshold value to define high risk patient, and it is highly specific, I think, this value. In line with current guidance from the American Society of Hematology and Thrombosis, we don't routinely use viscoelastic testing to assess the hypercoagulability, like TEG or ROTAM, rotational thromboelastometry. They are not accurate really in giving us or as a markers of hypercoagulability. Since antiphospholipid antibody is very important in such patients, we have to test for it also. We can also depend on anti-active factor 10 for detecting the coagulation state. And the regard and the putting in consideration anti-active factor 10 assay may be affected and give you false results in high level of pilorubins, which is mostly sometimes found in such patients, and also with high triglycerides, you will not get an accurate value of anti-factor 10. Treatment of such patients, of course, we have to depend on prophylactic anticoagulant, and as we see in thrombosis in COVID-19 can affect the liver, can increasing liver enzyme, can affect the lung mostly, and can give you a stroke or give you some gangrene or peripheral tissue perfusion defect. We can depend on either prophylactic or therapeutic doses of anticoagulant, but really there is no difference in the prognosis from using therapeutic doses, and prophylactic is enough. With therapeutic, yes, of course, it will give you a good guarantee against thrombosis, but will, the incidence of bleeding will be high. And so mostly most of the studies now depend on prophylactic doses of anticoagulant. Of course, heparin anticoagulation seem to be the obvious response to such a hypercoagulable state, in addition to its antithrombotic effect, which represents about only 30% of its action. Heparin has many anti-inflammatory effects, has anti-complement effect, and direct antiviral effect also, and that may be beneficial in COVID-19. Heparin also inhibits the neutrophil activation and binds the inflammatory cytokines and reduce the endothelial activations. And both the low molecular weight heparin and unfractionated heparin, and even heparin and undifferentiated heparin and low molecular weight heparin has the same effect. Only 30% anticoagulant, and the other 70% we must know has the other beneficial effect in COVID-19, anti-inflammatory, anti-complement, direct antiviral effect, and inhibit neutrophil activation and binds the inflammatory cytokines and reduce the endothelial activation. Heparin may directly bind to SARS-CoV spike protein, but it remains, as I said, unclear if therapeutic anticoagulation would provide additional benefit. Till now, most of the studies go ahead with the prophylactic doses only. except if in patient who proved to be thrombotic, actually is suffering from pulmonary embolism, suffering from DVT, suffering from stroke, we can use therapeutic doses of anticoagulation. Both Society of American Society of Hematology and the European Society of Hematology and Thrombotic recommend DVT prophylaxis in all patients on admission to using low molecular weight heparin. We can use prophylactic as 5,000 BID in adult, 5,000 units of heparin, or an unfractionated low molecular weight heparin enoxaparin. We can use 1 milligram per kg or 40 milligram per day. Unfractionated heparin in renal failure, of course, we have to use unfractionated if the patient accepting some renal problems. If the patient also accepting some heparin-induced thrombocytopenia head, we can depend on fondaparinux, but we don't stop the prophylaxis. Our current approach is based on ultrasonography screening for venous thromboembolism and intensified prophylaxis in high-risk patients. And we divide patients into three categories, 1, 2, and 3. 1, D-dimer less than 3,000 and no evidence of venous thromboembolism. And those patients receive standard DVT prophylaxis. Category 2, accepting D-dimer greater than 3,000 and ultrasonography negative, also receive intensified DVT prophylaxis. Category 3, proved to be suffering from DVT or from thrombosis, receive full anticoagulation, which is therapeutic dose, and for 3 months. In patients with high clinical suspicion of venous thromboembolism and no contraindication for anticoagulation, we have to give full anticoagulation and should be initiated empirically, especially even if the ultrasonography or confirmatory tests like angiography are not immediately available, and you find the clinical situation suspect mostly venous thromboembolism, you have to start full anticoagulation. What is the risk of thrombosis in COVID-19 outpatients according to patient comorbidity and family history? If he's suffering from risk factor for DVT or not? If the patient suffering from risk factor of DVT or he is not ambulating, she is pregnant, suffering from malignancy, the patient obese, taking hormone therapy, all the risk factors, we have to give prophylactic therapy for outpatients. Otherwise, no need to give anticoagulant. Consider post-hospital discharge thromboprophylaxis for 7 to 45 days in patient considered to be of high risk for DVT. You have to continue the treatment for 7 to 45 days. For non-hospital patient, for non-hospital patients, COVID-19 outpatients, anticoagulant and antiplatelet therapy should not be initiated for prevention of venous thromboembolism or arterial thrombosis, unless there are other indications or unless there is a risk factor for such patient. And it is an expert, highly expert opinion. Low-risk patient D-dimer normal or less than the other study or other protocol. For low-risk patients with D-dimer less than 2 of normal, no risk factor associated. No anticoagulation considers and encourage to stay active, ask the patient to be active, not try to be ambulating. There are currently insufficient data to recommend either for or against routine deep vein thrombosis screening in COVID-19 patient without signs or symptoms of venous thromboembolism, regardless of the status of their coagulation markers. There are currently insufficient data to recommend either for or against routine deep vein thrombosis screening in COVID-19 patient without signs or symptoms of venous thromboembolism, regardless of the status of their coagulation markers. For those with intermediate risk, D-dimer more than 2 normal on the charge, no risk factors, consider aspirin, and some other studies don't agree with aspirin administration and COVID. High-risk patient with D-dimer more than 2 of normal and immobility or has risk factors, venous thromboembolism history, hormone therapy, obesity, history of cancer, we have and no bleeding risk or low bleeding risk, consider you can give enoxaparin 40 milligram subcutaneous daily. You can give apixaban 2.5 milligram per oral BID, rivaroxaban 10 milligram daily. This is the oral anti, direct oral anticoagulant. And really in COVID-19, we don't like direct oral anticoagulant because of interactions and because of, especially in old patients and the obese patients and with other organ system affections, we are afraid from bleeding and the incidence of bleeding may be high. And so we depend mostly on low molecular weight heparin or unfractionated heparin. Low molecular weight heparin such as enoxaparin 40 milligram or higher, it is widely used in COVID-19 patients as a prophylactic. Also inhaled form of heparin that reaches the lung tissue may be effective in through anti-inflammatory and antiviral effects of the heparin, and many studies depend on inhalation even with the antiviral and the other drugs. Direct oral anticoagulant and antiplatelet agents are also useful in management of these patients. Available DOAC, as I said, includes the direct factor 10 inhibitors like apixaban, Lucas, and edoxaban, Lixiana, and rivaroxaban, Xarelto, and the direct thrombin inhibitors, Dibigatran, Dibigatran. And recently, all these drugs have antidote except edoxaban, Lixiana, no antidote for it. Specific reversal agents are available now. Dabigatran, we can use praxiban or edoxizumab. Apixaban and the rivaroxaban, we can use Andexa as a specific antagonist. But there is currently no specific authorized reversal agent for edoxaban. Direct oral anticoagulant should be used with caution, especially in patients with increased risk of bleeding, as older patients, patients with low body weight, or patients with renal impairment, also with a patient with malnutrition. Also in COVID-19, we can use tissue plasminogen activator and other fibrinolytic modalities may also be helpful in overall management, especially in a stroke or in MI and so on. To reduce the risk of over-anticoagulation and bleeding, healthcare professionals should ensure that warfarin treatment is stopped before DOAC are started. Because, and also with warfarin, we have to monitor the INR, and, INR frequently, and for all vitamin K antagonists, we have to mostly avoid them and shift to heparin, because frequent estimation of INR may be problems, especially in our patient. Most experts agree that Sinal for increased thrombotic risk is sufficient to recommend pharmacological venous thromboembolism prophylaxis in all hospitalized patients with COVID-19, as long as there is no contraindication. Missed doses are common and are likely associated with worse outcome, and we have to take care. Therefore, every effort should be made to ensure patients receive all doses which are written. L-thrombobash for patients suffering from severe thrombocytopenia and some problem in the bone marrow or aplastic anemia, we have to depend on it till the platelets go up. Catheter-directed thrombolysis can be used in patients developing pulmonary embolism and stroke. And also, local delivery of antiviral and interleukin 6 inhibitors is feasible, so many studies agree for this. Additionally, the use of catheter-based mechanical thrombectomy device, especially in cerebral stroke or other or pulmonary embolism. Transarterial drug delivery to the lung is undergoing popularity now because the blood flow to the lung at that time, at this stage of highly inflammation and so on, is low, and so they direct their drugs through arterial system of the lung or through transarterial local drug delivery is well established, including drug therapy delivery in the lung via bronchial arteries using microcatheter, even so in Ganz catheter. In renal replacement therapy patients, you don't forget to adjust the BTT and avoid the tube clotting or tube thrombotic. We have to give routinely 500 units per hour, so in case of continuous renal replacement therapy, or you can going up with your doses if the patient accepting frequent clotting of the tube. Compression stocking, if there is any contraindications to heparin or for systemic anticoagulant, you have to shift to compression stocking or non-invasive anticoagulant or non-invasive maneuver or sequential intermittent pneumatic compression device, electrical stimulation of the calf muscle or the stroke stimulation of the common peroneal nerve. You have to ambulate the patient and activate the muscles to avoid any stasis or any thrombotic problem. Duration of anticoagulation. Anticoagulant should be continued for 6 weeks for catheter-associated thrombosis and at least 3 months for venous thromboembolism. Convulsive patient with persistent elevated D-dimer greater than 2 times the upper limit of normal may benefit from extended prophylaxis or treatment. Really, there is much more research that is required to be performed, and I think all over the world now, too much research against the viral infection, and I hope good luck for our people. Thank you.
Prof. Ansary, thank you so much for this informative lecture. I think you covered all what we are asking about, and we have a lot of questions, if you please. As you know, we are seen by all the nationalities and from everywhere. So we have Mirisova. He's asking about how early anticoagulation therapy should start.
Really, anticoagulation should be started when after the first week or when we find the D-dimer starting to go up or C-reactive protein, if we can make investigation. C-reactive protein, you see C-reactive protein going up, D-dimer. Hello? You hear me or?
Yes, sir.
If you find the markers of inflammation that are high as D-dimer, C-reactive protein, procalcitonin, which inform you of infection, you have to, or LDH or ferritin, all these are markers for you have to start, better to start prophylactic. If the patient is in the hospital or if the patient has risk factor, if he is outpatient.
Yes. One question from Shiwi, he has confronted with a case, female patient, 68 years old with advanced rheumatoid arthritis and diabetes mellitus on insulin. He's asking, is there any need for anticoagulation, biologic therapy, immunomodulator, or antiviral at this stage for this patient?
In addition to her regular treatment, I think she is subjected to immune modulator treatment. She has to take prophylactic anticoagulant better for these patients. And we saw many patients really post-COVID suffering from arthritis, severe headache, some cognitive dysfunction. All these are related to exaggerated underlying antibody generated or the hyperactive immune system in such patients. And they exhibiting similar diseases like rheumatoid arthritis, like Graves' disease, like as in any viral infections, but in exaggerated form.
Yes. Dr. Fatma Gohar is asking why we hear about sudden death after complete recovery from COVID in spite of negative medical history, and for how long patient can continue on anticoagulant even after recovery and negative results?
Mostly the sudden death may be due to thrombotic complications, pulmonary embolism or heart failure or MI and such reason. Cardiac injury is, we found it in COVID-19 patients, also coagulability, hypercoagulability in any part of the body can affect the vital organs. And for anticoagulation, for such patients, so long as there is a risk factor, we have to extend the anticoagulant up to 3 months.
Yes, one.
And it depends, really, Dr. Essam, really depend, differ from individual to individual.
Yes, sir.
From
patient
high dimer, he has to take anticoagulant. Patient with a high risk for DVT, he has to take anticoagulant, prophylactic anticoagulant.
Yes, sir. One important question, because you know nowadays we are one of the family is infected and he can infect other people, and the most precious in the family is a pregnant woman. So Dr. Al-Minajid, he is asking about how to deal with pregnancy.
She has to be to receive prophylactic anticoagulant also, but with heparin, either low molecular or fractionated or unfractionated heparin. But don't give warfarin or vitamin K antagonist, and also don't give direct oral anticoagulant because they are not safe and teratogenic in such patient. But the pregnancy per se is a risk factor for some.
Yes, sir, if you please, I have one question. Some of the patients, and specifically we have Professor Adel Abfattah, and he's a specialist in the cardiac anesthesia. These patients, they are receiving either who are ischemic or they did already open heart surgery, and they are receiving already anticoagulation or antiplatelet. Is this one of the protection for this patient against COVID, if they are infected with COVID?
Yes, of course, they have to continue their treatment. And suppose coming to you patient on anticoagulant or with antiplatelet, he has to resume his treatment. Don't stop. And it is regarded as a prophylactic.
Yes.
I think it's very important to continue the anticoagulation, but change the type of from the long acting to the short acting before.
I told that, Dr. Raad.
Before the operative intervention.
Yes. Either better. Don't depend on direct oral anticoagulant. Depend on heparin, either low molecular weight or unfractionated.
Anyhow, heparin is the most important to start with.
Yes.
Of course. Yes.
Yeah. I think this is enough to take these questions to give a chance.
Please, Dr. Azam, I want to ask a very simple question for
yes.
Dr. Samir. What do you think about the personal variation, the age variation, the international variation in the development of the coronavirus?
Of course, the important thing till now in all the studies, it varies from individual to individual. All these are empirical methods and the protocol.
Can you explain the difference in pathology that happened?
Of course, in some patient exhibiting high immune response, some patient develop post-COVID syndrome, others not. Some patient experience high inflammatory state, others not. Some patient exhibiting prothrombotic state more than others, and so differ from person.
And this answers the question about the international variation.
And even in the same nation.